My name is Davide Rossi. I'm from University of Bologna, and today I'm giving an update about our pulp project. So this project is a project which is shared between University of Bologna and ETH Zurich, and we started this effort 5 years ago. And this is the list of people who contributed to this effort in the last 5 years, both from University of Bologna and ETH Zurich. So first I'm giving an overview of the project. So basically, the research project is about creating a low power computing platform for the end nodes of the Internet of Things. So basically, the end nodes of the Internet of Things requires to get some data from several kind of low power sensors, which can be very low bandwidth sensors, such as temperature sensors or pressure sensors, or sensors with higher bandwidth, like a microphone, imagers, or sensors for biological systems. So usually, this data is controlled and classified, processed by low-power microcontrollers, usually class M type of microcontrollers, and then they are transmitted through short range or long range wireless transceiver. So one of the biggest problems of these systems is that usually, the amount of power required from transmission of signal is dominating the overall system power. And so what you want to do is to analyze and classify the data on the hand node, on the sensor node, in order to transmit as low power as possible. And the other problem is that these systems are usually powered with batteries or harvesters. So they have a very low power budget. So from an application perspective, we see that depending on the kind of data we are going to sense and transmit, we have different requirements in terms of computing power. For very low bandwidth applications, like temperature or power sensors, so we need to read the sensors one time every minute or 10 minutes and just transmit data. So this is a very low compute intensive task, so we need a very tiny processor which consumes very low power, let's say in the class of processor of Cortex M0 cores. So for higher bandwidth sensors like accelerometers or gyroscope, we might need higher computing power, and this is more or less this computing power can be satisfied by Cortex M3 class of processors. While for other kinds of sensors, like microphones, we might need even a bigger computing platform, and this can be satisfied by Cortex M4 class of processors. And for those applications, for such application, and for some other applications, we need also to deal with high dynamic range of the signals and internal processing, so we might also want floating point units in the core. And this is covered by the Cortex M4F class of processor. But what do we do when we have higher bandwidth sensors which require huge computing power for this kind of microcontrollers, but we still want to be in a power envelope of a few milliwatts, okay, let's say 10 to 50 milliwatts. Okay, so the PULP project is trying to give an answer to this question through a multi-core computing platform operating in near threshold. Okay, so this is the main focus of our research. In this presentation, I'm not going to focus on the research of our universities, but I will mainly focus on the infrastructure and what is the available open source hardware and software, and what we plan to release. But basically, we are focusing on the whole complete stack of embedded systems from silicon technology, processor, hardware IPs, compiler infrastructure, virtualization layer, programming models, and also real embedded system implementations now. So we have developed a few applications with boards and sensors and so on. And so the whole output of our research, so all the infrastructure we used to build our research is open source, and is open source with a very permissive license, the shoulder pad license. Basically, with this license, you can take our software, our hardware, whatever, and you can do whatever you want, okay? Even not saying that you are using this this platform for your products or research or whatever. So, what is available? So, last year, in April 2016, we released the first version of the Palpino platform. So we took from some of the IPs from our main platform, which is Pulp. I'm going to explain it later. And basically, we build these very simple, basic microcontrollers, which includes a core based on the RISC-V instruction set architecture. So previously, it was based on the OpenRISC, but a couple of years ago, we moved to the RISC-V instruction set architecture. It includes data memory and instruction memory and boot up ROM, an AXI for infrastructure and an APB bus with a timer, interrupt controller, and some peripherals, which are UART, SPI master, SPI slave, JTAG, I2C, and GPIO, and a debug interface. In the open source release is also available the complete bitstream and software to implement this platform on the Z-board that we use as an emulation platform for the full system. Concerning the software, for the OpenRISC platform, we had the support for LLVM, but at the moment, the LLVM compiler for RISC-V is not mature enough. So we have a compiler infrastructure based on GCC 4.9, and we have some support for some additional instructions that we added to the basic RISC-V instruction set architecture to optimize the core for some DSP instruction I'm going to explain later. And the performance is 3.19 core mark per megahertz. So this is the old release of Palpino, which was released more than 1 year ago. And a few months ago, we made a new release of Palpino. So basically, as I introduced in the first slides, for different computing requirements of application, we need a processor that is able to achieve different workload with the best energy efficiency, okay? So what we released in the previous platform is the RISC processor, which is a 40 kilogate processor with DSP extension. Now, in this new release, we are going. We have released two tiny cores and one extension to the RISC core, which includes also support for floating point units. So the two cores with a very small area footprint are the zero RISC and the micro RISC. Basically, they are based on a two-stage pipeline optimized for area. They both support RISC-V compressed instruction to minimize the amount of memory footprint and memory required, which is one of the main constraints in very deeply embedded systems. So the area of the cooked two cores goes from 12 kilogauge for the micro Lisky to 19 kilogauge for the zero Lisky. And we kept the critical path at 30 logical levels, which leads to a frequency of 560 MHz in UMC 65 technology in worst case condition. So we have already done some tape outs of this chip in UMC 65 technology, and we are going to tape out another chip by the end of this month. So basically, okay, we optimized the area of these two cores. The micro Lisky features a 16-bit register file, and the multiply and divisions are emulated via software. And okay, sorry, this is 12 kilogates. While the zero Lisky, it has a 32 register hardware multiplier, which is 32 cycled, not pipelined, and a hardware divider, which is 37 cycles. So the big core that was already released more than 1 year ago is 41 equivalent NAND 2 gates, and we kept the frequency of the three processors the same. So we made our design optimized to reach the same frequency, which is around 560 MHz. So the DSP extensions includes fixed support for fixed point arithmetic, SIMD instructions. This means that you can do 2 6-bit operations or 4 8-bit operation, plus other extensions for clipping and this kind of stuff, bit manipulation instructions, and hardware loops to accelerate for loops. And in addition, we have also load and store instruction with automatic management of addressing pointers and so on. The new features of this core is basically the floating point unit. We have included an IEEE compliant floating point unit, which includes addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, square root, and MAC. And we have added also the support for two of the privilege modes supported in the RISC-V ISA. So concerning the area budget, as we can see, so basically from the big core to the intermediate core, we have an advantage in area of 2.2 times, which mainly comes from the simplification of the decode stage and of the execution stage, including the ELU. So we don't have all the vectorial operations, all most of the extensions. So we could reduce both the execution stage and the decode stage. While from the zero Lisky to the micro Lisky, the main benefit in area is comes from the basically the elimination of the unit for multiplication and divisions, and for the register file. Concerning the power, so what we have seen is that basically, no surprises here, when running a mixed arithmetic and control benchmark, which is CoreMark, we have a lot of reduction in power of the code plus control unit, because we have less instruction, and this stage of the pipeline is very simplified by this. And the other big source of power consumption in all the cores is the prefetch unit that we need to support the compressed instruction. So even if you see the power here, which is quite big, so we see a big advantage in this kind of compressed instruction, because here we don't have the power of the memory, But if we add the power of SRAMs, of an instruction memory here, it would be much, much bigger than the power of the instruction first stage. So even if the instruction first stage and the prefetch unit consumes a lot of power, this brings an advantage in terms of system power, because you have you reduce the pressure on the instruction memory. So we made some tests on okay, at the moment these are only a few applications which are representative for a very highly compute intense benchmark, which is a 2D convolution, a mixed benchmark, CoreMark, which is a mix of arithmetic and control, and a runtime benchmark, which is basically only control, so no arithmetic operation. So, as expected from the performance viewpoint for compute intensive kernel, we have a big advantage with the RISC-V core. And the introduction of the divider and the multiplier brings an advantage of 6.1 times. While, as you can imagine, in the runtime, we don't have a significant advantage with the extension of the other two cores. For what concerns the memory footprint, it's almost the same for all the processors, since all the processors support the RISC-V compressed instructions. So, okay, this is good. And if we take a look at the energy efficiency, which was the, let's say, the main target of our exploration and of our development, we can see that as we expected for the 2D convolution, the energy efficiency of the DSP core is much bigger than the other core. For a mixed benchmark, the core wins is the zero RISC-V, while for the runtime task, runtime benchmark, which is only control, micro RISC-V is slightly better than zero RISC-V. So I would say that the main benefit of the micro RISC-V is in terms of area, but not energy. So this is a very tiny core if you have if you need to do only control instructions. So this is what we have released a couple of months ago. In the next release, so in the last year, we have been focusing at the performance and energy at system level in our PULP platform. So Internet of Things applications, especially, let's say, smart Internet of Things, so I mean application in which you need to do some classification processing and so on, requires a lot of different I/O interfaces with very high bandwidth. So basically, in the original version of the PULP architecture, access to the peripherals was only possible through the APB bus from the processors or from the system DMA. So this was a really big bottleneck for the platform, because you had to manage everything with load stores. You had to add big buffers, you know, all the peripherals, because otherwise you were you had a lot of overheads with the interrupts to manage the saturation of buffers and so on. So in the release of PULP in 2016, so we have improved this by adding an autonomous micro DMA capable of handling and managing direct transfers from the peripherals to the L2 memory. But still, to control, so this is not completely autonomous. You have to manage several times the transfers from micro DMA to peripherals. And this is not very convenient to do that from the processor core. Another advantage of this approach is that you can overlap data transfers from the I/O to the L2 memory, data transfers from the L2 memory to the local memory of the cluster. So this is the parallel computing cluster of the architecture, and the data processing. So in this way, you create a software pipeline. You can overlap both all these kind of transfer, and you get better utilization performance. So in the most recent evolution of the architecture, which is the one that will be released hopefully next year, we have added a new set of high bandwidth peripherals, like a camera interface, I2S, the Hyperbus, which is a parallel bus which support a chip with the DRAM, external DRAM, plus flash and LVDS interfaces. So to deal with such kind of peripherals, we had to rework the SoC subsystem, which is this one. We have added a tiny processor close to the micro DMA, close to the I/O DMA, to manage all the I/O subsystem. And another thing we have added is this interconnect in between the micro DMA and the L2 memory. And now the L2 memory is is multi-banked and word level interleaved. In this way, you can have concurrent accesses from the I/Os to the L2 memory. You have accesses from the controller of the I/O subsystem, and you can have accesses from the accelerator, from the multi-core platform. And the fact that you have multiple banks with word interleaving minimizes the banking conflicts on the L2 banks and maximize the performance. The other, I would say, big improvement has been the introduction of the processing subsystem as a plugin for the SoC subsystem. So basically, what we are going to release next is this SoC subsystem, which will be the new Palpino platform. And then the hardware, the accelerator, can be plugged as just a plugin to this platform through dual clock FIFOs, AXI4 based interfaces. And yes, the other improvement we have done to the cluster is, as already told, the introduction of floating point units. So this brings an advantage both from the hardware viewpoint and the software viewpoint, because previously Palpino and Palp were two completely different platforms with two different runtimes, and it was impossible to support both of them with the same runtime, same software. Now we can do our job of research in Palp while supporting all the open source release of Palpino, basically with the same runtime libraries and yes. The tape out for this chip is expected for the end of this month, and it will be in 40 nanometer TSMC technology. On top of this, this is nothing new. I talked about these tools also last week. The news is that these tools are going to be released by the end of this year for Palpino and next year for Palp. We have a virtual platform which is basically an emulation platform, software emulation platform, that can be used to prototype runtime and applications on Palp and Palpino. We have a support for profiling tools and debug with GDB. At the moment, we have released only few of the IPs, our IPs, into GitHub. And the next steps will be the release of Palpino V2. So we agreed on the next name will be Palpissimo. And the release of this platform will be by the end of the year, hopefully. Yeah, the new things will be the new SoC architecture I described, the virtual platform, profiling, and the debug. While the release of Pulp is expected for next year. We don't know yet exactly when we are going to release, mainly due to the work to be done to implement all the software libraries and to make it usable for the users, basically. So I prepared this slide with basically all the known users of Palpino and Pulp in the industries. So we are quite happy because we have quite a lot of users. Some of these companies are using Pulp as, let's say, for doing trainings, for prototyping design flows and technologies. But I know that some other companies are really using our course in their product. And among those, there is this French startup who presented also last year, which is Greenway Technologies. And they are building a pulp-based industry processor, which is an 8-core pulp system, actually 9, because we have a fabric controller plus the parallel cluster. And the mass production of this chip plus Arduino-like evaluation boards are expected for Q1 of next year. Yeah, so so we would like, so basically these are the groups which are contributing to the effort or back to contributing. So to this group of group of groups, I would add also low risk, since I've seen they've ported some DSP functions to the Palpino, and also Ambecosma. They are helping to debug and providing some feedbacks about performance with the BIBS benchmark. And so we are still looking for collaboration and contributions on several fields, basically everywhere. Technology, design automation, architecture, software, but the main focus now is on application development, since we have a lot of boards with real chips, and we are using them for several applications in the field, for example, of embedded vision, biomedical signal processing, and audio. So if someone is interested in getting some boards, and try to do some, try to have some fun with the platform. We will be, it would be good for us to share the boards with you. Thank you.
I have a question about the low power aspect. How much of that is due to kind of logical design, and how much is due to the process technology?
So basically, the focus of our research is on near threshold design. Okay, and we have implemented some of the chips in 28 nanometer FDSOI technology. So what we see now. Is that so? If we compare this, so we have made really a comparison with current microcontrollers. If we take an STM32 and an FDSOI pulp chip, we see an improvement in energy of about two orders of magnitude. I would say that, okay, 1 hour, yeah, 5x is given by the technology, because STM32 is built in a 90 nanometer technology, but at least one order of magnitude is due to the near threshold design. So we do compensation techniques for temperature and the process variation, so that we can reduce the design margins. And also, we have worked a lot in microarchitectural optimization. For example, one thing I presented last year. So we have seen, we saw that a big amount of power, something like 50% of the power in our first chip was consumed on the instruction cache. Okay, so we had to find a way to reduce this power consumption. So we came out with a solution based on less-based memories. And this reduced the power consumption of the instruction cache by 4 times. And we have done similar optimizations and design, technology-aware design in other parts of the chip.
I'm wondering about micro-architectural patents. So there was a question to Alex Bradbury yesterday about, on Friday, when he was giving the RISC-V update about the RISC-V Foundation's efforts to build a bit of a war chest of prior art patents, just in case, you know, ARM get the shits one day and go after someone who's implemented a, you know, one of these RISC-V processors. Are you guys contributing to the patent pool there at all? Have you patented much micro-architectural stuff? And are Green Waves worried about this at all if they commercialize? And then, you know, there's an open source RISC-V processor in there, and, you know, some proprietary idiots get annoyed and come after them or something.
So what is the question?
Are you guys patenting the micro-architectural stuff?
No, we don't have patents.
Okay.
Right. So everything is open source with... So basically, the goal of our project is a research goal, okay?
Yeah, so but people are commercializing it now, right?
Yeah, but the main added value of Green Waves is not on the platform, okay? The processor is a, let's say, commodity. So I think that the added value of Green Waves is on the applications, and on the way you put together the IPs to get lower power, or one of the main key features of the Green Waves processor is a convolutional neural network engine, which is not open source. It's proprietary of the company.
Sure, but there is value in the Pulp platform, which, you know, I presume they're using. So yeah. There might be something valuable in there that might have been patented or something, or that you guys could maybe patent to protect people who use this platform.
No, the plan is to put everything open source with the solder pod.
Okay. And I notice you're using TSMC 40 for the next tape out you're doing. Are you guys moving away from the FDSOI research?
No. We are just. So basically, where we find. So we are not working in custom IPs. So our research effort is not on DC-DC, LVDS. So if we can find companies who wants to give us some of these IPs, is good for us, because we can test and prototype advanced low-power features, and we give back the platform and the silicon. So we are collaborating with Dolphin in this effort.
Do you know of many parts that have gone to production that are FDSOI using the body biasing stuff that you guys were working on?
How many?
Yeah, do you know if it's a popular process? Are there many chips that get mass produced on the FDSOI process that use the near threshold stuff?
So FDSOI is a very new process. Okay, it has been used by STMicroelectronics and NXP. And I know that there is one product of NXP, which is going to use, so there are two flavors in FDSOI. One, you can push FDSOI for higher frequency, and one, body biasing for to get higher frequency, and one to reduce leakage power. In NXP, they are using this process to reduce leakage power, and yes, this is applied in one of their products. But yes, body biasing is mainly used to compensate process variations or temperature variation in the industry.
Okay, so I was going to ask a question, but I see that we're running out of time now. But I was just a quick one. These boards you're talking about, do you have any information about those available online? Sounds quite interesting.
I think I have we have the design of the boards, but if you want to get the real boards, you should contact me and.
Yeah, cool.
Thank you. I may have had a great question. So how would you compare pulp with rockets? Like, what's your?
It's much smaller. Yes, actually, so we are working on. 64-bit implementation of RISC-V, which is comparable with Rocket. And this is a full system Verilog, not CISL. Yeah. And so the news of the last week is that we can boot Linux and type basic commands. And this is pretty great as a starting point.
That's pretty cool. And is there any plans to go like full open source? Like at the moment you release like, what is it, twice a year? Like is there any plans to put everything on GitHub and like to?
Yes. The only problem is that to put everything open source, we need a lot of effort to support people using these APIs. Yeah. So if we have a not a stable platform, it's a mess for us to support all the people, and it's a mess for the people to use the platform. So we try to release things step by step in order.
But wouldn't you get much more like people contributing to the project if you make it fully open? Because now, like I suppose, like you'll have internal repositories which are way off.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think that we could have more contribution, especially on the software side, if we provide us a stable platform. Because if people are not able to use it, then.
Thanks a lot.